I don't know what Josh could have been thinking. Taking that to school. And now I can't ask him.
One wrong decision, you know. Never would have thought Josh would have done anything like that.
He threw it all away doing something stupid. He could have had it all.
Let's go! Let's go, play it on, let's go!
It hurts.
When will our kids learn to stay away from these things?
One choice caused him to lose his life.
This is not a game. It's life and death.
And the fact that it's a hoodie just turned out to be a death sentence.
Hi, my name is Kat Graham. I'm an artist and a music artist and Liberian African American woman.
What's happening in the Middle East, what's happening in Syria, the conflict isn't ending anytime soon. So we really have to take the initiative and make sure that these people, these families, these people that are like you and me that have had normal jobs, that were dentists, that were nurses, that were in school, had to completely leave, flee their homes and what they've known.
Graham recently traveled with the UNHCR to one of the largest refugee camps in Jordan, meeting Syrian families who were displaced by combat at home.
Seeing so many people that look like me, I could have easily been one of them.
Has your perspective in life changed in any way after you visited the refugee camp?
Absolutely. You know, when I went there, I thought I was going to see these people that were broken by these by this terrible conflict. Imagine having to leave your home with only the clothes on your back and even maybe just a satchel, and even that, having to drop it because you're so tired from traveling the miles just to get to Jordan or the neighboring countries. I saw these enterprising, resilient people that were making a life for themselves in any way that they could. This is real. This is real. Listen, I'm not a politician. I'm not a news reporter. I make music and I act and I'm a human being, and I'm on here just to beg anyone watching that this is serious. And if we don't pay attention now, if we ignore this crisis happening right now, then we will have another refugee crisis on our hands, way worse than what is happening in South Sudan, way worse than what is happening. It will be unfathomable.
I don't have as big of a platform as maybe other stars, but whatever platform I have, I'm going to use it to support this incredibly important cause. This is one of the most urgent stories of our time, and I believe and I know that it really needs the world's attention.
Together and only together, can we unite and support each other through these trying times by giving hope to the helpless in Northeast Nigeria. I will be there to support this worthy cause and ask that you all do the same. Thank you.
I am so proud of you, and I love you so much, and I feel honored that I've known you for 8 years now. Yes, 8 years. I started playing your pretend mommy on The Vampire Diaries, and the most fun part about working with you is the laughter. How many times we got the complete giggles where we were crying and we couldn't stop. What is a humanitarian in my eyes? It's a person who uses the light of their voice and their consciousness to expose inhumanity in any shape or form, whether it be animals, whether it be humans, whether it be our beautiful, precious Earth. Congratulations, Kat Graham, on the Westfield IFF Humanitarian in Film Award. How amazing. It couldn't be more beautiful. To be a humanitarian is more special to me in my heart than anything else. The injustices that are exposed, The love in your heart and your elevated consciousness is an inspiration to us all. So please keep doing what you're doing. You're a beautiful singer, you're a beautiful actress, but beyond that, above all of that, you have a beautiful heart. I love you. Congratulations and thank you.
Thank you guys for being here.
Thank you all.
And there's also a chapel upstairs if any, I can marry off whoever they want.
Are you a minister too?
No, but I can be.
Oh, well, look at that. She's ready to do it. I just want to thank you for being here. And Kat isn't feeling well, so she still made this trip. And we're very grateful that she's here.
I just want to thank you for wearing red.
We had to match. I know
texted
it's hard.
Her before. I'm like, can we just do like a red moment? Thanks.
I'm not sure that you guys can tell us apart, but we figured it would be best this way. So I just wanted to say, I don't think I'm anywhere near as eloquent as Persia, but I think part of the reason that we wanted to honor you as a humanitarian is because we also believe that that is important, and part of the work that I think so many of us are doing as filmmakers is trying to share these stories and to enlighten people and educate people. And you're using your platform and your talent to help others learn about the plight of perhaps minorities in the world or those outside of our scope. And I thank you for that.
That's so nice. I love that you are using this, that you put, first of all, that you, can you just give her a round of applause? Because this is, honestly, I was a judge on a film festival, the Mammoth Film Festival this year, and it was all these kids kind of rallying together, just putting together a film festival. It is so hard, and it takes such chutzpah, and it's just, and the fact that you are in the stage of the film festival, actually including a humanitarian award, and I know that you guys have done this at least 2 years because Persia got hers, and I just, you know, I'm really amazed that you are having the foresight to do this now because this matters to you. I think how we tell what kind of stories we tell is really important, but I think the messaging of our stories and having integrity and the end goal of what we want to be as filmmakers is really, really important. I didn't go into my humanitarian work. I didn't even feel like the two were connected. When that first mission to Jordan happened, I was doing Vampire Diaries, and I felt like they were totally separate, that nothing was connected. But then throughout my time and, you know, the older I got, I realized that the roles I play and who I become and the kind of support that I give to other filmmakers or being a part of their filmmaking or financing any projects matters, that you can be a humanitarian just based on the kind of scripts that you are getting involved in, the kind of storytelling that you're doing. I mean, you know, making sure that there is some sort of an elevated consciousness to what you are putting out into the world, taking responsibility for what you are putting out into the world. You know, educating people and elevating them.
Absolutely. I think that's very important. And I know that the reason that we were a little late is because Kat was gracious enough to give us two interviews upstairs, so I apologize that you're going to have to answer this question again.
Okay.
But you received an Emmy nod for the PSA that we just watched, the Black Lives Matter PSA, and I just want to know or have our audience understand what it is that went into that and what was the impetus for producing that piece.
Yeah, I'm a little sporadic with my career. I'm a Virgo, so I like to plan what I like to do, but so much of my big moments in my career have happened so by the seat of my pants. Like, I mean, one of the first moments was like, I was working, doing beats for Will.i.am, and he was like, hey, want to go on tour? And I was like, all right. It was like literally through text. I was like, all right. And then we went on a world tour for 3 months.
Wow.
And then right after that, it was like the audition for Vampire Diaries. And I had shot 5 pilots up until that point and had absolutely no expectations. And it was like, hey, the show got picked up. Want to move to Georgia? And I'm like, all right. You know, everything has been so kind of, okay, I guess we're doing that now. You know, I think it's important to have a vision of who you want to be and what kind of person you want to be. But just even in terms of that spot, I was sitting next to this guy Van Graves on the plane, who was telling me his vision and how frustrated he was. And this was at the time where it was just nonstop violence happening, the police brutality and, you know, the lack of accountability within the system. And it was just like the height of it. And he was like, I really want to do this, but like, I don't know how to do it. And I'm like, I'll do it. Like, it's just been literally, you know, by the seat of my pants. And I think a lot of times, especially when you're trying to, because I have like 5-6 films that I'm trying to make right now, they're really, really hard. It's like, you know, get the money and then you'll get the actor. Get the actor and then you'll get the money, and then you wind up chasing your tail for years and you don't even know. It's so hard to make a movie. So anyone that's here that's really trying, like, I understand how difficult it is. And sometimes you just gotta just go. Just go with what you have, you know? I had enough money, and I'm, you know, have been with a cinematographer and director for a while now. So, you know, I'm fortunate enough that we have kind of an in-house production company. But also just do what you have, even if you only have like a YouTube, or even if you only have, you know, your social media or anything like that. Just use what you have and just go. Like, get your friends together. My friend Lex is like, hey, I want to do this short, and it's, you know, we're just going to film it. And I'm like, all right, you know, we just put things together and we just go. You know, we don't worry about, well, it doesn't look right, we don't have enough money, or we don't have this, we don't have that. So much of my career has been just like, okay, I guess, like, you know, just jumping out of the tree and just hoping that your wings start working, you know?
Well, I think a lot of the filmmakers in the room probably understand that sentiment. So can I ask, what films are you trying to work on? Where have you written your own projects? Are you working on producing? What are you looking at?
Well, there's one film. I'm always writing a film. There's one film I'm writing right now. It's like a Romeo and Michelle's high school reunion meets a girls'
I'm
trip.
I'm already in love with it.
It's super fun. It's the first comedy that I've written. And I have been working on about 3 different biopics right now. But again, like, financing an African-American biopic, as I'm told, is very, very difficult.
That's why you should have been at Tyler Perry's opening last night.
I know. Don't make me feel bad about it. I was too busy coughing in my pillow, being a loser. But if he can do it again tonight, I can probably maybe make it. So Tyler, if you could just redo that whole
Fingers
thing,
and
just
crossed.
Make sure Oprah's there again. Thanks.
We'll get a call out to him.
Yeah, no, something.
We have that reach.
And I've been working on a couple different shows. I have one that I have with Damon Wayans. I have one that I'm working on with Reggie Hudlin. So I've got a lot of things. I mean, you know, when you're producing, it takes time. It takes, you know, my partner Darren has a film that he's been working on for 10 years. And it's a process, you know. It really, really takes a lot of time. I mean, you have to find not just the actor that believes in it, but a great producer who also believes in it. Or you just fund it yourself and cut a trailer together yourself. I don't even know what the answer is, you know. I'm 30 now. I've been acting since I was 5 years old, and I'm still not sure how everything gets made. It's sometimes it's a fluke. Sometimes you get a great financier, and sometimes you're writing it and it gets in the right hands, and something that you weren't even thinking about making gets made.
I feel like we just need to call up Marvel, because they somehow have it figured out, and I just want to be a part of that. And maybe they're, you know, have their budget as well. Then they seem to know how to get movies made.
Yeah, they got it down pretty tight.
Fortunately, none of us are there yet.
But I don't know. I think that there, at one point, like, Stan Lee wasn't Stan Lee. He was just a guy telling really great stories. And even, like, the creator of Ninja Turtles, it was just kind of like a side fun comic book that he was making, and they had sold maybe like 10 copies of this comic book to a comic book store, and then it kept flying off the shelves. And he was like, it's just a stupid thing I was doing in my free time, like Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, like, who cares? He just thought it was a fun thing for him to do that he inspired him, and then it winded up becoming the massive franchise that it was. So I think that if we start looking at things like, oh, I just want to be Marvel, or I just want to be Turtles, like, I don't think that's the way to do it. I think we should hold our ideas precious and treat them like they already are that, and know their worth and invest in them, and the people that believe in them will find their way to you, and you keep working towards them. But just, you know, Stanley wasn't always Stanley.
No, absolutely. We all start somewhere, and you have to have your dream, and you have to have the passion to chase that dream, and it doesn't happen overnight. And I definitely agree. A part of our motto is to dream big, so continue to do so, and then chase those dreams. You said something just before about the Ninja Turtles, because you're the voice of April in the upcoming. So I wanted to talk to you a little bit about that, about what it is to be a woman of color stepping into this role, who has been historically, April O'Neil has been a white character, and what that has meant for you.
You know, I didn't really understand race as much as I thought I did until actually The Vampire Diaries, because the character was originally Caucasian and a redhead in the show. And then when I auditioned for it, I didn't think anything of it. I mean, everyone, all shapes and sizes, were auditioning for this character, and I didn't think that I couldn't do it. I said, well, they should just hire the best actor. And I even had a meeting with a director for another film this week, and I'm like, well, you should just hire the best actor. And if I'm not it, then go hire the best actor. I think I'm it, because I'm the best. But if you so happen to find someone better, go with God. And that's just been my attitude my whole life, where I don't think about, is this right for me? Is this not right for me? Is this anything like that? I'm like, well, I want to be the best at it. And if I don't think I'm going to be the best at it, I won't even audition. That's how crazy I am. My agents are like, what do you mean you're not auditioning? So-and-so wants to see you do this tape and come in for an audition. I'm like, no, it's not my role. I don't want it. And I don't think I'm the right person for it. But here are three other actresses that I think you should definitely see. I have a very defined idea of who I am and what I want to bring to the world. And I think with the cartoon, it was like, well, I didn't really, I knew that they were going in a different direction, but I didn't really understand the level of what it would do for the kind of animation series world. I hadn't understood the impact of it on, I hadn't understand the impact of the show. I think it's really important that, not just if you're African American, but that there are more types of women being shown, and that we are going to play, produce, write different kinds of women, different kinds of girls, and telling different kinds of stories, you know.
I think that's really important, and it's an inspiration that you do have such a strong sense of self, because not all of us do, and I think it's something that I personally aspire to, trying to define who I am and having a stronger sense of self. But I love that you empower other women, and that you would think to suggest somebody else for the role if you don't feel that you're right for it.
Yeah, they don't like it when I do that.
Well, I mean, we're in a rat race. Actors, filmmakers, all of us are kind of in this rat race where we're comparing ourselves to one another, and it's kind when there are people who are willing to pass the baton, or at least open the door for someone else. I think that's really important. But I don't want to hog the mic, because we are limited on time. So do I have questions from the audience for Ms. Graham? Don't be shy now. This is your time to shine.
Even if it's something that you like don't think that I might have the answer to, or just something that's been like bugging you about the industry. Yeah.
Favorite movie.
There we go.
Big question.
It's a big question, and I'm a nerd, and people will be like, that movie? But I would say The Matrix. The Matrix. I love the Wachowskis. I've been a fan of the Wachowskis. I love anything that's like mind-altering, dimension-altering, like a Fight Club or Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, or like, you know, movies that kind of change the way we see reality. I'm always big on those. You?
Me? Ooh. Brazil. Blade Runner. And Back to the Future.
Back to the Future is awesome.
Back to the Future.
I still go to the Universal Studios tour. In a hat. And I love the whole, like, and this is where they film blah, blah, blah. And if you look to the right, you'll see the Jaws thing. And I'm just, like, taking pictures, even though I've done it, like, 100 times. Yeah.
That was a good one. Thank you for bringing that up.
It's a great movie.
Do I have anybody else out there? Oh, right over here.
Hi, how are you? Mike McCarthy. I was an IATSE stagehand for 30 years, so I'm on the other side of the camera. What kind of advice can you give to my son who wants to be on your side of the camera?
You want to be an actor?
Yeah.
Are you in class?
Going freshman. Yeah. Get freshman.
Yeah, film academy.
Whoa. Awesome.
That's great.
I mean,
You got in. That was a start.
It's like just what your dad had to do. We just have to look at everything like a job, too. Just be like, just train your ass off, you know? I think that I always thought that I was pretty good, but then I became completely like absorbed by it. I think like when I booked the show, I had left LA. I was like engaged at the time. I had a full life. And then I was in Atlanta and I had no friends. I was kind of cut off from everything, and I could have just like done the party thing. I had a couple cast members who just did the party thing, and I was like, no, I just wanted to get good. So I became completely obsessed. I read every book from Michael Caine to Stella Adler to who would become my coach, Ivana Chubbuck, and I was so obsessed with my coach that I actually crashed her Christmas party and begged her to coach with me. She had no idea who I was, and she was mortified that I literally stepped over velvet ropes to beg her to work with me. I became so obsessed that I don't do anything without coaching for it. I won't even audition without coaching for it. I became obsessed with movies and actors and scripts and how to make a movie and how to edit it and film financing and everything around it. I became obsessed with who made what and what actors were a part of what and their process. I just became completely obsessed. And I think when you become obsessed about the actual art of it, you win. You win. You've already won. You know, you don't have to like ever become I'd rather be like a Daniel Day-Lewis than like necessarily like I won't name who else, but somebody who's just known for being pretty and acting in big blockbuster movies. You know, I'd rather just be really, really, really good. And I think when you are really, really good, that's all that you ever need. You know what I mean?
I think that was some really sound advice. And so passionate. And that's half of it. You have to be passionate about what it is that you're doing. And once you lose that passion, that drive, I think you've lost that battle. If you don't really want to do it, then you're not going to do it.
Right.
Do I have any more questions out there? Oh, I saw one over here, and then I'm going to come back to you, okay?
Give me things you like more in certain aspects of like live action acting or voice acting or,
Oh, I want more of everything. I'm like every filmmaker in this room. Like, I'm like, oh, I want to do this. I want to do a really brilliant thriller. I want to do a massive sci-fi blockbuster. I want to do all the biopics that I talk about. I want to do a really cool indie, I play a character unrecognizable. I'm so obsessed with what I do for a living that I just really want to tell as many stories, great stories, as possible. There can be a lot of money attached to something or no money, but if the script sucks, I won't do it. It's always down to like the script and having like really good characters and stuff. But I feel like, yeah, I think next would be a really cool biopic or sci-fi would be really, really fun. I see all this Marvel stuff and I'm like, I want to do it.
Well, hopefully, we don't know. It might be on the horizon. I think I put it out there into the universe for you.
I think everyone also wants to do a Marvel one. But if there is I know that they're doing the new Dune and I'm a huge Jodorowsky fan. So like, anything that would feel like within that would be like totally up my alley, you know?
That was a really good question, thank you. And then right over here, we had a question.
Is it hard to be an actor?
That's actually a really hard question. What's your name?
Nicole,
how old are you?
I'm 13.
Is it hard to be an actor? I wish that when my mom had me acting when I was your age, that she would have kind of sat me down and said, like, listen, there's going to be a lot of rejection, and it's going to be not based on how good you are. It might be based on the color of your skin, your hair, things that really are not important. Even though I'm like, got it together for you guys today, my hair is not that important. My clothes are not that important. My mind is the most important thing that I can share with you. My face, my beauty, it's not important. How I think and how good I am as an actor, that's the most important thing. And sometimes you're just not going to get it based on things that aren't that important. but it's what, you know, they need for a character. And I wish that my mom would have sat me down and told me about rejection a little bit earlier. And I think when you have a career that can be based so much on like what you look like, I think it can mess with you a bit. And I'm grateful that I was kind of like a loner anyway, so I didn't really care about being the prettiest or the most popular or anything like that. But I wish that I had that and it would have been a little bit easier. And I think with social media, it can be really, really hard. Whenever you are looking outside of yourself, when it comes to whatever career you want to do, it gets really hard. And it's not other people necessarily making it hard. It's you comparing yourself to other people that makes it hard. So I think the second you stop comparing yourself in any job that you do, things will get a lot easier and more fun.
That's a really good question. Thank you, Nicole. I think we have time for just one more question. Oh, and I see a hand shot up in the back there.
I'm actually inspired by, this is gonna sound actually not great. I'm inspired by actually fans that I meet. There's just this genuine kindness and generosity of anyone that comes up to me and is like, actually, I really liked your work. And I'm like, the fact that anyone would spend a minute watching me of their lives and felt inspired by me, like that's, I want to have that in my life. That kind of, gratitude and glee, and it's also exciting and cool and new. And I think the people that I encounter that are just that excited, I don't understand it, but I want to carry that with me for everyone that I meet and everywhere that I go. And then I'm inspired by like risk takers. Like I'm obsessed with Jim Carrey and like Helena Bonham Carter and crazy artists like a Salvador Dali or, you know, Hieronymus Bosch. I'm really inspired by people that just go left on you. Grace Jones, you know, not who necessarily people would think I'm inspired by, but I'm inspired by people who are so unapologetically themselves. That's literally, those are just goals for me. So those are the people that inspire me.
Thank you for that question, and thank you all for being here.
Yeah, thank you guys for being here.
So we actually have some wonderful films lined up for you after this. So if you will just stay in your seats, please. We're going to start playing those movies, and we will get Miss Cat Graham back home.
Yeah, so don't sneeze on anyone and contaminate this town.
So that she can rest.
Yeah, but thank you guys for being here. And I'm not sure what everyone does, and if you all are filmmakers or if you're just big dreamers or just want to see some good film, you know, just be conscious of what you put out into the world. Just try and say, is me putting this out going to help the world in any way? Is it going to help make somebody's day better, help them forget about what they're going through, help bring awareness to certain issues, you know? And it doesn't have to be like corny or hitting people over the head with it, but just be aware of what you're putting out into the world, that's all.
Thank you so much
for that advice. Thank you so much. Thanks for having me, guys.